Good morning. Good afternoon. It's not evening. I know that much. How is everyone? Good. Thank you so much for getting in here, and we've got an exciting program for you, and I get to start it off now. So my name is Jenny Toomey, and I'm the International Director of Tech and Society at the Ford Foundation, and it's my honor to welcome you to the first ever Public Interest Technology University Network convening. So cheer. Great. So just over a year ago, 25 university presidents and provosts met with some funders and a number of professors to discuss a huge challenge. There was no clear and robust pipeline for technologists to leave the academy with their degrees in computer science and engineering or data science and find employment not in the private sector, but in public service, working in government, at NGOs, or in philanthropy. These were all places that desperately needed technologists, and we had no clear strategy to deliver them. We identified numerous gaps that needed to be filled if we were going to build this field of public interest technology, something akin to the existing system of public interest law. And we haven't solved all those problems yet, but we're making some good progress on the PIT challenges at the Academy. A year later, we now have 21 universities who have committed to break down the silos between computer sciences and the humanities and policy and law. We've raised $3.5 million to support the network, with $3.1 million of that going out to a set of university grants that are proposed by the network members, and we're going to announce those for you later today. We've got almost 30 other universities asking to be part of the network, and it's not everything that we're going to need to do, but it's a pretty good first year. I'm pretty proud of the PITUN. So let me start by thanking those universities who believed in this and agreed to join something that didn't exist. And I want to thank the funders who've supported the work, so the Schmidt Foundation, Siegel, Hewlett, McGovern, MasterCard, and Jeff and Tricia Rakes, who are joining us for 2020 PITUN. The New America Foundation need to get thanked as well, because Andreen's done an amazing job knitting the network together with her partners, Anne Marie, Cecilia, Afua, and the New Venture Fund, who actually built the fund so we could make these grants. I want to thank Jessica and Shelley for their work on that. And finally, the Friedman team, who've been with us every step of the way, helping us think through this challenge, articulate it, take off bite-sized pieces, and give us good advice from the people who are actually doing the work in the universities to get a sense of what would be the first, most important things for us to focus on and invest in. So thank you, Tom and Kelly and Kyle and Maria. And then finally, I should thank Georgetown University, because it's very hard to do something the first time, and to have Georgetown be a partner in volunteering to host us the first time, that's a really big deal. So it's going to be a really amazing day. I'm going to get out of the way, and it's my great honor to introduce you to Provost Bob Groves. He's shown incredible leadership at PIT at Georgetown. He's been willing to collaborate and experiment from his history in government. He knows just how important it is that we develop these pathways, and I want to welcome him to the stage.
Thanks, Jenny. Thank you very much. And I welcome all of you who are new to Georgetown, to this little hilltop campus. We are, in our own mind, an institution devoted to building successive generations of women and men in the service of others. So it is a perfect kind of event from our perspective to host, and we're honored to be here. This institution has always had a spirit of helping this nation grow. If you notice the iconic Healy Hall, it doesn't face the river. It faces Washington, D.C., deliberately as a symbol of our desire to give back to the country. When the Civil War was over, the colors of the school were chosen deliberately to be blue and gray as an attempt to heal the nation after that horrible breach. And Today, the people in this room are trying to make a transition collectively as well. We see in our lives technological change occurring at a rate that's unprecedented, yet we want to figure out how to use it to build a better society quite intentionally. And I think a lot of us have come to the conclusion that this cannot be done as a side product of careers that are solely devoted to a culture of fail fast, break things, disrupt. We need something else. So collectively, I think we envision intentional development to use technology to solve pressing problems of the world, construction of successive cohorts of technologists who devote their energy to those goals with sophisticated knowledge of ethics and policy frameworks, and at the same time and in parallel, construction of successive cohorts of policy experts who are technologically expert. So this is going to be hard work, can't be easily done. I don't think it can be done with the normal competitive spirit of universities. It requires a new coalition that Jenny described. Universities have different strengths. They need to bring them to the table in a cooperative way. The basic curricular content of this field hasn't begun to be mapped out. The pedagogical strategies are being invented right now, and the faculty talent that we need in the future hasn't been fully articulated. As she said, we're attempting an outrageous thing to do, to build a whole new field, and there will be logical phases of this field, I think, and we are at the beginning of this, maybe in the first and second phase of this, we're taking low-hanging fruit of internships and ethics add-ons to existing curricular and joint programs with private sectors for cooperation. The second phase is that we're beginning already across the universities is the construction of new programs, degree programs that take this issue head on, and the construction of case studies as part of the content of those programs. But the real brass ring at the end of this is a real field, a field that has all of the attributes of most academic fields. It has a literature, it has theory, it has applications, it has journals, it has professional associations, it has schools. That's a lot of work to do. We're at the beginning. It's really excited to be a part of this. It is an open system, as I see it, needs to be an open system. And we're propelled forward by a set of far-sighted funders who see the same vision we do, and it's together that we can pull this off. So let me welcome you to Georgetown. I hope you enjoy the presentations this afternoon, and let's keep going. Thank you.
Okay, so we have incredibly exciting conversations planned for you today. People who can talk about why PIT is so critically important in academia and government and the private sector. But we wanted to start with something more fundamental. As a funder of technology policy for 10 years, I've been in thousands of conversations with peers and grantees and funders where people have othered technology. And I would say, like, are you concerned about the issue of surveillance? Or I'd say, what do you think about all that big data that's being collected and that we're not really sure what's going on with that? Or have you heard of this thing called net neutrality? And to a person, for many years, they would say, you know, that's interesting, but we don't have a technology program. Or we don't do technology. Or even worse, we work on social justice issues. We don't work on technology. All the while, technology was completely transforming the landscape where democracy and justice can or cannot exist. And for that reason, we wanted to start off today with a conversation that makes that crystal clear. Anyone walking off the street could see this panel and say, yes, I understand how important this problem is and why we need to solve it. This panel has that in spades. But before the panel starts, we have a really short film that we're going to play for you, and I just want to make sure we're ready to play that film. And I want to remind you that film is a technology.
Together, we believe that what the illusion of supremacy has destroyed, the truth of equality can nourish. Thank you.
Hold your applause. Hold your applause until I say it's a picture wrap by David Oyelowo and Carmen Adogo.
Ava gets performances, I think, out of actors that they don't even know is in them.
Keep your eyes on Dr. King. Be thinking in your mind. Good-looking brother right there.
There was enough trust which built up my confidence to the degree that I would make choices that I otherwise wouldn't.
When she hooks you, she doesn't let you go. These characters don't let you go.
Why did you ever say anything?
No,
Ma. I don't know, Ma. What is that? So I win? Huh? Why don't you say anything? Say something.
What do you want me to say?
Maybe my expectations are so low at this point, I'll accept anything from you.
She wants her audiences to step inside someone else's life, inside their mind, and to therefore be changed.
Few directors capture the beauty of us as black people like Ava.
She's got so much light and vision.
Missy Elliott, and I'm an MC.
Why the hell are we out here in the middle of nowhere?
This house is yours. Ours. I had it built for us.
I've never seen anyone with such intense, passionate, willful, and clear direction, and yet be such a calming force as well.
We must stand up!
You march those people into rural Alabama, it's gotta be open season.
Focus on family.
We now have more African Americans under criminal supervision than all the slaves back in the 1850s.
We are the products of the history that our ancestors chose. Products of that set of choices that we have to understand in order to escape from it. We should go looking somewhere higher.
Be a warrior.
I'll try.
Going to be tested every step of the way.
Why are they doing us like this?
What other way they ever do us?
And I haven't looked back.
I've been having these dreams. Since I keep hearing these footsteps. And they come in closer and closer.
That's me coming and bringing you home.
They said if I went along with it, that I could go home. And that's all I wanted.
The police would do anything. Lie on us, it would lock us up, it would kill us.
This is my life.
I don't think we should admit to something that we didn't do.
Okay, you keep fighting.
In the 1960s, there was a problem in the legal profession. There was an abundance of people who needed low-cost or free legal representation, but there were too few lawyers who worked for the public interest. And so in the 1960s, Ford and other foundations partnered together to create the field of public interest law. Today, almost every major decision in our lives is mediated by technology, and we face a similar problem. Too few technologists are foregoing the high salaries of the private sector to work for the public interest, and too few policymakers, lawyers, and all of those around them understand technology. Today marks a key moment in the movement to correct that and to create the field of public interest technology. And we have quite a panel to discuss that. One quick point of order before we go any further. This panel will end at exactly 2:25. We have some extraordinary folks in the panel who are going to board planes pretty soon after 2:25. So bear with us on that front. But it is my pleasure to introduce our panelists. First to my furthest left, Professor Latanya Sweeney. Latanya is a professor of government and technology at Harvard, and I and many others consider Latanya to be the leading public interest technologist in our country. And of course, beforehand, she was very modest and was like, you can't say that. Her work as a scholar, a public servant, as a professor and a publisher has consistently made our world a more equitable place and one that is more secure from digital invasions. You can read a lot of that work at her journal, Journal of Technology Science, techscience.org. To Latanya's right, we're joined by Ava DuVernay. A Peabody Emmy and BAFTA winning director, whose work has systematically exposed structural racism in this country. You saw glimpses of her most recent film in five parts, When They See Us, which talks about the lives of five extraordinary teenagers who were falsely accused, imprisoned, and then exonerated for a crime they did not commit. She is a force, and we're lucky to have her, Ava DuVernay. And finally, I'm joined by Darren Walker, president of the Ford Foundation. When Darren became head of the Ford Foundation, he became head of one of the largest philanthropic endowments in the world. And at that time, that endowment was working for many different goals, towards many different ends. And soon after taking the helm at Ford, he decided that it should work towards one, inequality. Addressing, exposing, and combating the crisis, what you call the global crisis of inequality. And Darren, of course, has been a driving force for the philanthropic partnership that made this movement of, and this field of public interest technology a reality. So one last time, and well, one more time, a hand of applause for our panelists. I want to dive right in, and I want to start with you, Ava. I promise you're going to know the answer to this one. One of the things that made When They See Us so extraordinary is how you show that what happened to Antron and Kevin and Corey and Yusuf and Raymond wasn't just about what the police did to them. It was about, you know, how the prosecutors built their case and how newspapers covered that case and how TV covered that case and how powerful people use that case to their own benefit in countless different places in the system. And from watching 13th, it's clear that this work isn't a coincidence. Exposing structural racism in our country is a central focus of your work. And that's not a small task. And so I would love for you to start by talking about how and why you made that decision to have that be a focus of your work.
Well, thank you all for having me. I'm happy to be here. I don't know why I'm on this particular panel, but I'm gonna try to fit in as best I can. I think, you know, for me, it's all about disrupting systems. You know, we can look at, you know, racism on its face and feel the deep emotional impact of our lives interrupted, our lives kind of challenged on a day-to-day basis, or even on a generational basis by bias, as is the case in the lives of the boys that I chronicle in When They See Us. But the overall goal, that film is not just about those five boys. Mm-hmm. It's about systems of bias. You know, that it's a four-part film that each part talks about a system. The first part is talking about police interaction, precinct behavior, arrest protocol, the systems around first interaction of black and brown people with law enforcement. The second is about court systems, public defenders, jury selection, judges, defense attorneys, that whole system and what it's about. You're following the story of the boys. Really, it's wrapped inside a larger question about, should we not interrogate these systems? And so each episode really is dealing with a different system of the criminal justice system. And whether it's me and my own work with the help of Ford Foundation, looking at the systems around filmmaking, exhibition, distribution, production, marketing, all these different systems that don't really allow a freedom of movement and expression in the way that we think. It's the same with the criminal justice system. The same with technology I'm learning, which blows me away. Like, we are ensnared within these systems, and it's really about going beyond addressing the individual story and really trying to understand how our story fits into the larger story, which are systems that need to be interrogated and often dismantled.
And can I just say on this point that the brilliance of When They See Us was your ability to take storytelling mm-hmm. and deconstruct the systems and the impact of those systems on people's lives. And I think one of the reasons we wanted you on this panel was because you demonstrated in an analog world, circa 1980s, how these systems worked. And there are many people who believe that as we transition to the digital world, that those systems will be necessarily improved and be better. And I think what Latanya is demonstrating is that that is a hypothesis that is yet to be proven. That in fact, the very systems, technology-based algorithmic systems, are just as susceptible to bias. And that we should not assume that this new technology is any less biased than the systems that you showed quite clearly, quite powerfully, were completely biased against those boys.
Yes, and we have actually begun to see exactly that. So starting from something as simple as Google searches. Mm-hmm. If your name is, your first name is given more often to black babies than white babies, we saw arrest ads that would show up, even implying that you had an arrest, even if the data system didn't have anyone with that name have an arrest record. And the companies would run ads, had basically run ads on all adults in the United States, but it had this incredible sort of adverse impact on people whose first name was given more often to black babies than white babies. We've seen all of these kinds of, and so that was sort of the first time the question of the Civil Rights Act had come up. To what extent could you even know that that happened? We've seen, when I was the chief technologist at the Federal Trade Commission, we were able to see really different kinds of ads for credit cards coming up on websites that were frequently more often by blacks than by whites. And they would be some of among the worst possible credit card ads. If you look at the browsing history of a household, who you are, really everyone sort of visits the same websites in the top 10, you know, the Google and Facebook and so forth. But after number 10, it depends very much who you are as to which websites you visit. And the more the website houses people or invites people that are closer to you in more and more intersections, the more you trust it. And the fact that there could be this kind of disparity in those ads of credit card offerings is really huge about what does that mean for the Credit Reporting Act. And then, of course, there's been the Fair Housing Act challenge with respect to the ads on Facebook. There's been recidivism algorithms used to determine whether or not a person should be held for bail or released. And they've been shown to have extreme bias in them, so that you get these incredible disparities between a young girl who, you know, by most the conscience of America should be allowed to go out on bail, and in this egregious situation where a multiple offender, white male, is allowed to go home. Also, the same thing comes up with sentencing and so forth. These algorithms are hidden from view, and our ability to be able to sort of see that is pretty amazing. I just have to say, I'm a computer scientist, and
not only are you a computer, she was the first woman, black woman, PhD, MIT. Give it up for Latanya Sweeney. Yeah.
I'm a computer scientist.
Right. I know, she's like, I'm just a computer scientist.
Yeah. Well, the only thing I was gonna say was that many of us came into technology in a belief that technology would build a better tomorrow, that it would right many of the wrongs that society had produced. And you can imagine how shocked I was when I saw those ads, for example.
And that's what triggered it, right? You can you talk a little bit about how you started that study about the search ads?
Well, I had just started at my professorship at Harvard, and I was being interviewed by a reporter. And I typed in my name to pull up a paper that I wanted to share with him. And I said, oh, there's the link to the paper. He said, forget that paper. Tell me about the time you were arrested. And I said, well, I was never arrested. And he says, then why does that ad say you were? And it said, Latanya Sweeney arrested? ? So in order to convince him, I had to actually click the link, pay the money, show him that the company didn't have anyone with Latanya Sweeney, which is a really unusual name anyway. Had no one with that name had an arrest record. But then the question was, why did this happen? You know, sort of my 11-year-old son calls this the day my computer was racist. He said, so I ended up doing this study. I spent 2 months doing thousands and thousands of searches to unpack what was really going on.
So bias, algorithmic decision-making are pervading these major decisions and interactions we have with our government, with the private sector, with our employers. So, you know, you would think that the government agencies empowered to protect us in these spaces, from the Department of Justice to the Department of Labor to the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission or the FTC, Federal Trade Commission, should be just chock full of public interest technologists ready to identify these problems and solve them. Is that the reality today?
No.
And can you talk a little bit, and perhaps Darren, you can as well, about why that is, why there is that gap?
Well, I'll jump in. When I was at the FTC, we did some amazing things about uncovering these kinds of issues. And primarily, the FTC is full of mostly lawyers with a small contingency of economists. And the chairwoman at that time said, you know, we need more people like this. We need more people doing this kind of work, because in many ways, what we really were seeing was all of these acts, all of these laws already existed, but how do you redefine them in today's technology? They have to sort of redefine themselves. But when it was time to go figure out who to hire, then we realized there was no one trained. Because it's not the same as computer science, and it's not the same as social science, and the sort of disciplinary silos really failed to deliver the kind of person that we needed.
Mm-hmm. And Darren, I just think on the demand side, we have not created the pathways. Mm-hmm. So we have a supply challenge in that we, I think, have a community of young people going into CS and going into the humanities who would like to be able to meld these different disciplines together. But university systems actually disincent that kind of interdisciplinary work. Right. So we have a supply challenge. And then on the demand side, if you're in government, there isn't necessarily a pathway into the FTC or the EEOC or any, and we have those agencies which still primarily live in an analog world.
Right.
And so we've got to, and what we at in foundations can do is help to provide the catalyzing seed resources to pilot and test some of these ideas and to partner with the public and private sector, and especially universities, because universities are critical to the kind of societal transformation. Universities are always at the center of transformation in society, certainly in this country have been, and we won't solve this without having universities change their behavior.
And so, Ava, you are sitting with an extraordinary computer scientist to your left, an extraordinary attorney by training, and now one of the nation's leading philanthropists to your right. Let me just speak about lawyers. Lawyers tend to not be storytellers, right? And I'll go out on a limb to say most computer scientists also are not storytellers. And what we've heard is we need some stories told. Right, so one of them is the CSI effect, right? So prosecutors report that jurors believe that forensic science is perfect, you know, and they demand that that there be forensic proof of everything, right? Because it's perfect. How do we pop that bubble, right? How do we start convincing folks that yes, you know, what's in the crime lab is all sorts of fancy, but it's all sorts of bias too. Or it may suffer from bias also. And on the other side, how do we tell a story to students, be they computer science students, be they young law students, that, hey, maybe you know you shouldn't go make six figures plus at selling ads, right? And instead, you should make a little less money, but work for the public interest. You know, there's some real persuading that needs to be done. Any advice for how we non-storytelling folks can do that in a way that's effective?
Well, we're all storytellers. Everyone will walk out of this space and talk about what happened here, and you'll tell the story about what you learned. Yeah. So it's important to have more forums where we can understand that when you, this beautiful blonde woman up here, Googles her name, it'll be different than this beautiful sister here who Googles her name, that there will be different results just based on their names. Mm-hmm. That's astounding information that enough people don't know. Thank goodness Dr. Latanya Sweeney had a journalist. Can you imagine a journalist is standing over your shoulder asking you information about your groundbreaking work, and a full arrest record pops up. He's like, well, tell me about that one time you got in trouble with the popo, right? And she has to try to figure out in that moment and reconcile what it is, and it's leading to a real disruptive approach to understanding these systems that will hopefully take us into and usher in a new understanding and a new way of of exchanging information. But the idea that we need to create more forums like this, more opportunities to share with each other, this is not something that is, yes, it's very detailed. Mm. You know, there's part of it that I'll never understand. Algorithms and all the X's and O's, and I barely made it through algebra, like it's just not gonna work for me. But I do know the real world effect on it on my life. And it's only because I had the opportunity to hear Dr. Sweeney speak about it. Mm-hmm. I would have been in the dark. Yeah. So I heard her tell the story. I've tried to tell the story. I was talking with her backstage. I was like, can you help me with my story? Because I need some better techniques to share this with people. I'm so passionate about it. But the hope is that we can give enough information and that we can continue to talk about it, classes about it, scholarship opportunities and fellowship opportunities and job opportunities, but also the creative community needs to really step in and start to embed it in our very more entertainment-based storytelling. Mm-hmm. You know, how many cop and lawyer shows do we see? If I would have known about this, I would have put some of it in when they see it.
Yes, now can you in Queen Sugar in your next film? Come on, we got to figure out how you
it's done.
You
it's
can
done.
Do it.
It's
you can
done.
Do it. If anybody can tell that story,
it's
you can.
It's done. I feel like there may even need to be a 13th like documentary feature financed by Ford. Come on, you know
with support from the Ford Foundation.
Yes. But the bottom line is take the information that you hear here, and all of you know so much more about it than I do, and can speak about it in ways that people like me, who are lay people, can really understand.
I love this idea. Mm-hmm. What you did with 13th.
Yeah, we should.
Which transformed. You all may not know this, but there was a woman who went to see 13th on a whim. She just went to see it, as she describes herself, a nice white lady on Park Avenue with a lot of art in her apartment.
Fantastic.
She went to see it. She'd never heard of Ava DuVernay. She sees this film. The next day she calls me and she said, do you know Ava DuVernay? And I said, yes. And she said, she has changed my life. And literally this woman, who is a big arts patron, took her favorite painting off of her wall and sent it to be sold, and sold it for $165 million.
Wow.
And she said, I want to give $100 million and work with Ava on fixing what she showed me was wrong with our criminal justice system in that film. That's the power of storytelling. And just like so many people like Agnes Gund had no idea that our 13th Amendment actually said it was legal to enslave people who are charged with a crime. People didn't know that. Mm-hmm. I don't think people know what we're talking about here, that actually algorithms can be inherently as biased as any two people who are inputting things in Linda Fairstein's office in 1986. I mean, right? I'm sorry to go there, but
that's
hello.
True. Yeah, absolutely. No, I mean, this is transformative information. When I first heard the good doctor talking about it, I was fortunate enough to be at a convening that was, you know, sharing all kinds of ideas, and I could just never shake this. So hopefully the point is that we can, in answer to your question, continue to tell these stories. I certainly want to be a part of it as I tell stories professionally, but we all are constantly telling stories. The idea that the story that technology is telling about us is not, could possibly not be our true story.
Right.
Makes it just as important as you know, any crime thriller that I might be covering for Netflix. So, is Netflix biased? Ooh. Okay, Dr.
There's
Sweeney.
Been some privacy issues with Netflix.
But anyway, there's lots to share.
So I want to make sure to leave some time for audience questions. But I thought maybe the last thing we could reflect on here before that is the classroom. You know, what this looks like in the classroom. You did not offer this class when I was there, but it's called Data Science to Save the World. And you also run the Data Privacy Lab. And I'm wondering, you know, what does this look like in the classroom? How are you connecting the dots for the students? You know, do they get it the moment they walk in, or do you have folks who, you know, oh, I thought I was gonna work for, you know, Facebook, but now I clearly need to do this, you know? Tell us about that.
So in Data Science to Save the World, we take 5 real-world problems, and by the end of the semester, we offer a kind of solution to them. And the students are just excited. So these are undergraduates. They come from all kinds of disciplines, so it's not regulated by discipline. And the students have had just powerful effect. The way it started was when I left the FTC, I realized that a lot of what we were doing wasn't actually rocket science. that it was really about understanding technology and looking for the unforeseen consequences. Like, where does this go wrong? Where are the adverse impacts? And that I could teach this to students. So I offered the course, and I told the students at the end, if you're going to do a project of your own design, and if you do a really good job, I'll take you to DC and give you an audience with regulators. And I set aside money to take two students. 26 students crossed that bar. And so with help from Ford, actually, we brought 26 students to DC. We ran it like a project fair, and the regulators came. It was supposed to last 2 hours. It went for 4 hours. It was really amazing. The room was electric. The regulators, which were typically, you know, mostly white guys in their 50s, were regulating technology they'd never heard of. The students are early adopters of technology, and here they were showing them how this was all going wrong. And it was really powerful and really amazing. The programs that they wrote went directly into agencies, and really changed the way they operated. We then took those original papers, and that's what started the Journal of Tech Science, and they had profound effect. I mean, one of our students, I'll just tell you, I mean, just so many great stories. They ended up on the Today Show. I mean, just all kinds of things. I'll just give you one example. One of the students, Iran, there had been for 2 years reported that Facebook Messenger was dropping your geolocation every time you would leave a message so that you could see the geolocation of your friends and friends of friends. And the industry media had not really been able to get Facebook to change it. So Iran made a little browser plugin that you could download, and he put it online, and like 90,000 downloads happened within a week. And within less than a week, Facebook changed it. It was really powerful, and we had these kinds of effects on government regulations, just all other companies. I just want to say my students are responsible in great part for Airbnb changing its practice, which turned out was a price discrimination issue. Hosts of different races offering the same accommodations but not getting the same amount of money. Airbnb did a great thing. They came up and they said, look, we're just going to set the price. And so anyway, so our students have done some amazing things through that class.
Imagine a world where every major university has two or three Latanya Sweeneys there. So folks, we're going to open it up to questions. We have about 15 minutes. And I think perhaps just raise your hand. Oh, those are the questions. Oh, wow. All right. So funny. Thank you. Okay. Okay. So, all right, first question. When we speak about this field, we often use the brief but useful descriptor, quote, tech for good, close quote. Google and Facebook define, quote unquote, good very differently from the ACLU or the leading critical scholars. Who defines these words, right? Who, you know, what is included, and how do we develop a framework for thinking about and evaluating the, quote unquote, good of technology?
I think we have been very unwavering in our idea that this must be rooted in the notion of the public interest. Mm-hmm. Because words like good and evil, and they have been appropriated and turned into branding slogans. Mm-hmm. And we must let those branding slogans go off and do their thing. But the idea of the public interest is the space where the private interest and our interests intersect. Mm-hmm. And that is often a contested space. Mm-hmm. We did not have in this country, before the creation in the 1960s of public interest law, we had never as a nation named anything as the public interest. There was an entire system created of laws that came through litigation all the way to the Supreme Court, which named something public interest and gave legal standing to pursue it to citizens and put in place government agencies to regulate on behalf of the public. So there was no environmental law. Mm-hmm. There was no EPA. Right. There were no legal clinics for the poor. All of this was created in an effort to promote the public interest, which often seeks to ensure the resilience of the most vulnerable people in society. We need today, in our new digital world, to articulate and defend and protect the idea of the public interest in a digital world. And unfortunately, that public interest has been defined primarily by private interest and corporate interest. And we saw that in the hearings, the congressional hearings of the technology executives, where we saw the intersection of capitalism and democracy. And democracy lost. Mm-hmm. And part of the reason democracy lost was because our policymakers, our congressional representatives, had no capacity to respond to the tsunami of private interests that had already articulated. Right. And so basically you had technology executives telling Congress people what the public interest, what they have decided the public interest is, because there are not in those, they're not on those congressional committees the way there is in every other facet, whether it's the environment or financial services or healthcare, experts there advocating and protecting the public interest. We don't have that in technology. And that's where universities come in. That's the system that we have to create so that the public interest is protected and promoted.
And I just want to say that that interest isn't just about race either. Like in 2016, our group was the first to find that the voter registration websites that were vulnerable to hacking. And the fact is those vulnerabilities still exist on those websites. I mean, the issues are just every democratic value are sort of up for grabs by what technology design allows or doesn't allow.
We have another excellent question. We've been talking a lot about how to train these folks and put them in, you know, in seats of power or near seats of power. But an audience member asked kind of a different question, which is, how do we get it into neighborhoods? How do we get it into underprivileged communities to empower and help others to overcome systematic inequality? So we've been talking about kind of aiming up. How do we aim at neighborhoods and the streets? I remember, Ava, this really powerful moment towards the end of 13th where Van Jones says, he just gestures to his smartphone. He says, the simple fact, you know, that anyone can just record an interaction with a police officer forces a conversation, right? And so smartphones are pretty pervasively adopted in the country, definitely not totally pervasively adopted. But how do we make sure there are more empowering technologies reaching folks who have less? I don't know if any of you want to reflect on that.
Please
solve this foundational problem.
I do think this is also a part, like when I talk to students and we talk about working in the public interest technology, we talk about the phases of technology design and that at every phase there's a different intervention that you can do, whether it be technology design or it comes into the marketplace, the kind of add-ons you can do or the kind of shaming, like I gave the example of Facebook and Airbnb. But more and more students are also choosing alternative technology. The idea that they will actually build technology to right a wrong. And I think that that's a space in which it allows us to literally can be quite groundbreaking.
I mean, I think that clearly in communities, we've got to design the kind of interventions that we see that include technology, right? So there are in my space, there are lots of philanthropists who are interested in funding youth serving programs. All right, you should be funding Black Girls Who Code. You should be funding the organizations that look like the organizations that you normally are interested in, but they're doing technology in community. So community development organizations, yeah. Right? Everyone, this system, everyone has to change in order. But the good news is, like it always, in communities, they're already ahead of us. There are organizations that are working on the ground doing incredible work around technology. We have to help resource them and give them the supports they need to actually serve their communities. But this is already underway.
Right. And when you think of the civil rights movement and the youth movement within that, whether it be Vietnam or civil rights movement or black liberation movements at the time, really led by young people, you know, it became from an awareness of the technology at the time, television, and seeing something like the beatings of the Selma Bridge, right? Seeing that for the first time and stepping up and responding to it. The challenge is that this bias, this real violence to communities of color, to people of different gender identities, to just the American voter, all of these different segments of us feels very hidden inside of the idea of technology, which should be free and open for all. And so it really is a question of what will be the moment of impact where, in a widespread way, people become very aware of, I mean, you know, it's kind of like rushing hacking doesn't seem to be enough. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like what is going to be the thing that makes the young person feel it, that makes all of us really feel like, oh, okay, my phone, my computer, my profile, my Google name, my name, all of that is at risk if we don't lean into this. If we don't have some social action around it, some protest around it, whether you know how to do it or not, we should be up in arms that these are possibilities. And not possibilities, it's actually happening. So for me, my question is a lot around how do you amplify rooms like this? How do you make sure that it's known? And unfortunately, I think it usually comes at a moment of impact that feels very emotional to people. And the question is, what will that be?
But I think it's a really interesting insight that you just said about how in the 1960s, television was the intervention, the innovation, the technology that made visible and no longer deniable. So seeing those young black people being beaten on the Edmund Pettus Bridge, seeing American citizens having dogs and fire hoses, it made white people in this country see things that they had never seen, at least in such a saturated way in terms of media. The same way the smartphone was used to record that black man being shot in the back down in South Carolina, when we have said these things have happened throughout our history in this country, and yet many people simply said, oh, well, that just can't be. Mm-hmm. Now we have the technology to actually demonstrate, yes, it can be, and yes, it is mm-hmm. our experience mm-hmm. that police brutality has been happening, mm-hmm. and we now can show you, right. And you can no longer deny or seek to change the subject.
Sure.
That it must be dealt with.
Sure.
And that's the power of the storytelling that comes
sure.
from these simple advances in technology.
Mm-hmm. Hello, thank you. Roger. Lest you think these are all softballs, there's actually a good hard question here. Darren, you mentioned, you know, Black Girls Who Code, and in my mind immediately pivoted to different but similarly grassroots organizations like Color of Change or Mi Gente. And Mi Gente has been busy exposing the role of Palantir in supporting immigration and customs enforcement's deportations. And the question here is, are there lines that you think universities and foundations shouldn't cross when they partner with the private sector, given the fact that in other settings, the private sector often succeeds, and sometimes in universities, the private sector often succeeds in setting the terms of debate or in affecting the development of knowledge. Any reflections on this question?
I absolutely think there are lines that we shouldn't cross. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think the public interest is different mm-hmm. from the private interest and private capital, right? So that's why public-private partnerships, which we think are great, have to really be understood, because in our system, mm-hmm. private capital, private interest generally does not work in the public interest. It's not working for the public interest. It's working on behalf of private capital, of shareholders, of people who are investing in that enterprise with an expectation of a return. Mm-hmm. There is an inherent tension between the public interest and the private interest in our society. And that is the way it's supposed to be, except that the public interest is now fighting with one arm behind it, right? So from my standpoint, there are absolutely lines that should not be crossed, and especially given what we have seen in recent weeks around private mm-hmm. philanthropy being used to whitewash the reputations of unsavory people.
Right.
We have to be very careful.
This is a big theme, and perhaps you can have the last word, Ava. In 13th, the intersection between private capital and the prison industrial complex. And so I don't know if you have any other reflection to offer based on the experience of diving into that terribleness.
My only reflection is that I think the last word should be Dr. Sweeney. So what do you think about things?
Well said.
I mean, she's...
You're my hero. Come on.
Can you say something to make us feel better about all
yes.
that we've talked about? Something hopeful. What do we do, doctor?
This room is full of young people who are excited. I had the luxury of having, I don't know if they're here, but I had the luxury of having dinner last week with a group of students who started coding forward. And they were saying that we've got 3,000 students who want to work in this space of public interest technology. How do we move forward? And I thought that was very cool.
Amen.
So I have hope.
That's tremendous hope. That's a wonderful note on which to end. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for our extraordinary panel.
Thank you.
About technology in the public sector is that it'll perpetuate a lot of the problems around exclusivity, inequity, that already exist.
My biggest fear is algorithmic bias, and I think about this a lot. So the world is becoming increasingly more data-driven, and to me that's really scary because we don't actually know how companies and organizations are using this data.
While technology is a force for good in our society, I think that it doesn't work great for everyone. I think that there are groups that are left out and left behind.
The disparity of access between different groups and different populations, there definitely is a disparity between who has access to these new technologies, who has access to the data.
We are moving closer and closer every day to a surveillance state.
The social and political structures we've built can't deal with the incoming technological change.
I interned at the Los Angeles Police Department's Information Technology Bureau and was at the same time working with the Los Angeles Mayor's data team. It was the first time that I had seen government and technology intersected.
I could see the way fields that I had been really passionate about and also fields that I had never heard of before could intersect, and I could study all these things that were really interesting to me.
I took a class with Professor Latanya Sweeney on data privacy and how technology and different aspects of that can help change the world.
City of Miami, working on something called Get Housing.
Scraping Twitter data to analyze the different communities and different public reactions to the anti-vaccination movement.
I'm about to start working on a project with a professor here at Smith with a reproductive justice group.
A project to simulate bike sharing so that we can judge the impact of those systems on lower income individuals.
My work focused specifically
on housing justice.
I'm the co-founder of The Move, which is a movement to help rebuild our public's muscle for democracy.
Right now, I'm trying to understand how Twitter bot accounts interact with American political elites online.
I'm able to, for the first time, like explore these more social science-y questions about the impacts of data on our society.
I think education most helped me realize as a technologist, and this is totally in hindsight, is that effective public interest technologists really have to be both generalists and specialists at the same time.
Exploring public policy topics from a computational lens and way to influence policy that will make the world a little bit more equitable.
As data and technology have begun to really revolutionize the medical space and medical industry, there need to be voices in the room that understand and can anticipate adverse consequences that data and technology can have.
We need to design systems and promote equity and fairness in all of the ways that we use technology in our society.
Being able to build and tailor these services so we can touch everyone, helping on diversity and inclusion.
As the world gets complex, we need as many people as we can tackling the societal issues that are going to arise, and I hope to be one of them.
So what do you think? Are you convinced? Was that a good first panel? Yeah? That's what I think. Okay, so now we get to do something super exciting, which is we get to cheer for all of the different universities who have gotten awards in this first year of the Public Interest Technology University Network Challenge. And we got to get it all done very quickly. So we've got a clear strategy for how we're gonna do this. So we know that we've got this big gap in doing this work at universities and getting universities to incorporate this vision into different areas and to pilot ideas. And that's why we're excited to be announcing these $3.1 million worth of grants to 21 colleges. And we're gonna do it. We've got three of the different foundations coming up here to read out the grants that are being received, and then also Andreen from New America is also going to come and join us. And the way we're going to do it to try to get this done quickly is we're going to read by category. So we had these four categories that people could apply in: educational opportunities, career pipeline placement, faculty and institution building, and strengthening the public interest university technology network. And I'm going to do the first round, and one by one, I'm going to announce the winners. And when the project is called, I hope the principal investigator, anybody on the team that's in the room, will stand up and stay standing, but hold your applause, because once we've announced everyone in each group, we're going to just cheer and knock the roof down with how excited we are about them. And then I'm going to pass the mic, and we'll have someone else do the next category. So is that clear? We got it? We all know our roles? Who are the clappers? All right, good. All right, so my category is the area of strengthening the university network. And the idea of this is basically to connect educators working in the public interest technology and provide shared resources and opportunities that'll build this field. So the grants that we made this year include Howard University, an interactive platform and repository of case studies for teaching teams and students. Please stand up. Good. Georgetown University's cross-disciplinary workshops for professors working in computer science and law. Harvard University, developing a network of 50 researchers and educators across institutions to develop a deeper understanding of how new technologies will impact the public interest. The University of Texas at Austin, in partnership with the University of Michigan. The Schools of Information at the University of Texas at Austin and the University of Michigan are partnering to organize the first annual PITUN Undergraduate Informatics Education for Public Interest Technology Conference. So buy your tickets. It'll be in Austin in the spring 2020. So please join me in recognizing these important first projects. All right, Katie Knight from Siegel, please come up and let us know a little about Siegel, and then let us know who won.
Okay, I'll try to get to the good part fast. Hi, I'm Katie Knight, Executive Director at Siegel Family Endowment, a foundation focused on understanding and shaping the impact of technology on society. I think our mission alone should tell you why we're so excited to support this work, right? To understand, to expand our shared knowledge base about what's happening to the world because of technology, and to shape, to have a positive impact on where this is going. Universities and the public interest and this network are obviously poised to understand and shape the impact of technology on society. So I could probably just give all my money to the fund and be done with it. I don't think my boss would like that. Also, I enjoy being employed, so I won't do that, but really, really excited about the work and thrilled to share with you the inaugural cohort of grantees in educational offerings, which is the next category. And I'll remind you to hold your applause till the end, but to stand as I make my way through this long list. Thanks, Jenny. So, projects in the area of educational offerings aim to create curriculum and experiential learning opportunities that offer students the chance for cross-disciplinary learning, and I think we've heard a lot today about how important that cross-disciplinary learning is. So grants made this year include Stanford University. The Race and Technology Praxis Program will educate students to assess the racial implications of new technologies while developing practical skills to shape their development and use. Columbia University, a summer workshop collaborating with community partners in New York City to create new curriculum and processes and build new technologies that support long-term community goals. University of California at Berkeley, a project to co-design an enriched experiential curriculum that bolsters students' technical and non-technical ability to work across disciplines as leaders and innovators. University of Virginia, an interdisciplinary graduate-level course called Innovation in the Public Interest, providing students a structured experience in the development of public interest technology for actual government sponsors. Miami-Dade College, in partnership with Microsoft, Code Miami, and the City of Miami, MDC students will develop the Miami Budget Project, a bilingual open source platform that will allow citizens to participate for citizen inclusion in the budget process of the City of Miami. Carnegie Mellon University, a project to bridge the ethical gap in computer science education by teaching students socially responsible language technologies. City University of New York, two grants. Grant one, developing new curricular materials to help codify public interest tech as a course of study and share these materials as open educational resources. Grant two, a project to recruit a cohort of 24 graduating high school students into a Pitt pre-college summer program that will lead to their enrollment at CSI St. George during the fall 2020 semester. University of Chicago, a project to develop a new integrative course on public interest technology led by faculty from the Harris School of Public Policy and the UC School of Social Service. And Massachusetts Institute of Technology, a project to match students with backgrounds in computer science and urban planning with city agencies to assess their vulnerability to cyber attack. Please join me in recognizing all of these incredible projects. And now I'll turn it over to Nicole.
Good afternoon. My name is Nicole Lindsay. I work at MasterCard in the Center for Inclusive Growth, which is the philanthropic hub of MasterCard, and a bit of a think tank within the organization. I also manage operations for the MasterCard Impact Fund, which is supporting the public interest tech work. And across the board, our work is really focused around making the digital economy work for everyone, everywhere, which obviously you can see the link to the work of the Public Interest Tech University Network. So the projects that I'm going to talk about, they're funded in the area of faculty and institution building and aim to aid in pre and post-tenure faculty in their efforts to develop public interest technology programming for students. Grants in this area include Miami-Dade College, the Geographic Info Systems for Environment and Community project will include a college credit certificate that will generate a dual enrollment program with high school students and will place them in the pathway of associate and bachelor's degrees, allowing them to continue for a master's of science and create a project learning platform. Georgia Institute of Technology. The Southeast Region Public Interest Tech Faculty Fellows Program will convene a cohort of 16 technologists and social scientists to create interdisciplinary projects addressing historic and continued equity challenges in the southeastern United States. Party Ran Graduate School, a project to create a curriculum intended to facilitate discussion about the ethical implications of artificial intelligence among Party Ran graduate students and Rand researchers. Please join me in recognizing these important projects. I'd now like to turn it over to Andreen Soli from New America to announce grants focused on the career pipeline and placement.
Hey there. Hello, everyone. Hi. My name is Andreen Soli. I work at New America. And my role is the manager of Pitt UN. And I also want to announce that the application cycle is open to become a new Pitt UN University member for next year. Done that job, right? And so in my category is career pipeline and placement. And projects in this focus area aim to provide new models for career training and placement and to support individuals looking to build a career in public interest. Grants made in this area this year, Princeton University, a summer internship that immerses computer science students in real-world policy issues by pairing them with consumer protection agencies that deal with cutting-edge challenges regulating technology companies. The internship will provide students with a stipend and defray travel costs. Olin College. This grant will support three new initiatives, including support for students partnering with outside stakeholders on Pitt work, summer fellowship for students to practice Pitt in multiple environments, and an event and conversation series on campus about engineering policy and society and the responsibility of engineers. And I just want to note that there is a student that is involved in the project and she was able to come today. So I'm really excited about that. Carnegie Mellon University. This project will develop an open access, open source policy innovation lab starter kit and fellowship program that formalizes the PIL framework, helping Pitt UN members adopt coursework in the PIL model that encourages rapid experimentation and viable solutions that directly meet end users' needs. Sounds really fun. Georgetown University. Should be all these Georgetown folks in the room. Georgetown University's Ethics Lab and Center for Security and Emerging Technologies, CSET, are partnering to develop innovative and replicable workshops on artificial intelligence and ethics for three nationally recognized fellowship programs that provide training and embedded experiences towards government careers in technology policy. Arizona State University. Thank you. The Community Innovation Fellowship Program will forge a partnership between ASU-led expert and Citizen Assessment of Science and Technology, ECAS, network, and the Association of Science and Technology Centers, ASTC, to train the next generation of science engagement professionals who can work collaboratively with local civic government and university partners. University of Michigan. A project to identify Pitt career paths and constraints faced by persons of color by generating descriptive statistics, hosting facilitated workshops, and communicating results publicly. Pepperdine University. The Leading Smart Communities Professional Certificate will engage local government leaders with leading practitioners to share the latest trends in government technology. And Florida International University. Florida International University, FIU's Panther X Fellowship Program will create an experiential learning platform for a new generation of thinkers working at the nexus of the public interest and frontier technologies. Please join me in recognizing these important projects. Thank you. Thank you very much. Turn it back to Jenny.
So thanks to all the funders for doing that, and thank you for all putting your proposals in, and I can't wait to see what comes from these grants. There's now going to be a 15-minute break, which you've earned, and I don't want you to go too far, though, because our next panel is going to be with FTC Commissioner Noah Phillips and FCC Commissioner Jeffrey Starks, and it's going to be facilitated by our fantastic journalist, Manoush Zemirodi. So you don't want to miss that. 15 minutes, and then back in here for the final panel of the day. Then we have workshops, and then we have cocktail hour. So please, get ready.